All right, cheers. Hi, I'm Billy, and this is Steve. Right, we're just going to play a few songs tonight and sort of, you know, I don't know, talk about the songs a little bit, about some memories about them, some thoughts about how they were written or, just basically not in any chronological order or anything, so it could seem a little scattered, some of the memories, but I think it's a nice way to do it. I think if we went in chronological order, it could get, I don't know, I like moving it around. I don't want to just stay in one period. I like to shake it up, you know, I like to. Anyway, let's have some music. Let's start with Dancing With Myself. Down in London town to go-go, with the record selection and the mirror's reflection, dancing with myself. Is it no one else's side in the crowded lonely night? Yes, I went so long for my love vibration, and I'm with myself. Oh, dancing with myself, dancing with myself, when there's nothing to lose and there's nothing to prove. Dancing with myself. And I'll be with myself, oh, dancing with myself, dancing with myself, when there's nothing to lose and there's nothing to prove, dancing with myself, oh, 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 oh. To dance, if I had the chance, I'd ask me to dance. If I had the chance, find out, stand to cover. And ask you all to dance. If I had the chance, and ask me to dance. If I had the chance, find out, fans in Dallas, come out, San Francisco, let's fucking dance. Oh, 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 oh. It's all wet, yeah, I'm gonna sweat. Woo! Yeah, I'm gonna sweat. myself. Believe me, dancing with myself. Myself, I'm alright. Generation X, and I came across the Atlantic in 1981, March of 81, and I was living in New York, and I hadn't met Steve Stevens yet, so I really was at a loose end. I really didn't know what I was going to do. I didn't even know what kind of music I was going to do. I know I'd just done what we'd done the Gen X album in England, but I didn't really know. I'd come to America to start kind of a solo career, and I really didn't know what music I was going to do, so I was walking around Manhattan going, what the fuck is Billy Idol? I know what Generation X is, but I don't know what Billy Idol is necessarily. And what America at that time was into radically different music than in England. You know, we're so radically different. I mean, there were so many kind of, I don't know, they were at one point, they were like hard rock, serious hard rock bands that had gone very commercial. And it was a totally different scene. I mean, it was completely different to England. I mean, the fashions were like, you know, diametrically opposed at that time. So I was thinking, well, how do I fit in? And then I thought about how I sang. You know, at that point in time, most of the groups were harmony bands, and they would all sing incredibly high up. And I'm going, how the fuck do I fit in? With everybody singing, you know, in the stratosphere when I'm way down here, you know, or something. So I thought, fuck it. There's only one thing to do, and that's to go out and get completely plastered. So I went to this club up on the west side, because I was living on the west side in Manhattan. I went on the 80s, or the early 80s. The 81st, I think, there was a club called Hurrah's, and it was kind of like a small club. It was like it had a bar and stuff, and then there was like a little dance floor, and there was all these kind of couches and settees around this dance floor, which was empty. There's nobody on the dance floor. There's music playing. There's a DJ. Everybody was around the bar trying to get a drink, and so I just can't get through all these people to. I want to get plastered, really, fuck me, I don't know what I'm doing here. I don't know anybody, shit. Give me a fucking drink, but I can't get through to the barman because everybody's in the way. But anyway, suddenly, the DJ put some song on and everybody left the bar and they were just running lickety-split, you know, like over these couches and settees, just, and then on the dance floor going fucking crazy, and I was just going, shit, this is great, I can get a drink at last, Christ. Right, mate, I'll have a screwdriver. So while I'm waiting for him to give me the drink, I sort of go, well, I wonder what fucking song that was. You know, I wonder what song that was that got all those, like, enabled me to get my drink. I wonder what song it was. And when I listened, I went, fuck me stiff, it's Dancing With Myself. And then I soon started to find out that it was really big on this underground dance chart. There was it was called a New Wave dance chart. And there was, I don't know, people like Joy Division and Simple Minds and Generation X, Gen X. We were on it, you know. So I realized at that moment when I saw that, I realized I don't have to change a thing. I know who Billy Idol is. He's the guy who did Dancing With My Fucking Self. You didn't have to change a thing, and I think that's the fun of life, isn't it? That you sometimes you don't know what you're doing, you're in the middle of nowhere in a country, but the music is what held us together. I think it's just a fantastic feeling. Right, we're going to keep rocking with a song from the Rebel Yell album. That was a really big album for me and Steve. as we'd done the Billy Idol solo album in 82, we'd met up through my manager at the time and Steve's manager, Bill O'Coyne. He managed Kiss, and he was managing me, and he knew Steve, and it was just a great pairing. And anyway, we'd done the first Billy Idol solo album, but the Rebel Yell album was really what I think really cemented our musical relationship and our personal relationship. This is a song from Rebel Yell. This is a song we don't often do that much, or we did try in 1984, we tried to do this next song about four times. Whenever we did, it was really difficult to do, but I think we've cracked it. So we're gonna do Catch My Fall. I will say, yeah, I'm just a like a girl on a record machine. When it comes to rocking, she's a queen. Hold my baby on a Saturday night. I wanna love her and I hold her tight. Well, she lives on the 20th floor in town. The elevator's broken down, so I walk 1, 2, 5, 3, 5, 4, 5, 6, 7, flight 8, flight more. On the 12th, I'm starting to drag. 15th floor, I'm ready to sag. Reach the top, and I'm too tired to rock. So I call to Chicago for repairs. Till it's a fixed, I'ma use on the stairs. Hope they hurry before it's too late. I want my baby too much to wait. Well, this went on for a couple of days, but I couldn't stay away. So I walk 1, 2, 5, 3, 5, 4, 5, 6, 7, flight 8, flight more. On the 12th floor, I'm starting to drag. 15th floor, I'm ready to sag. I reach the top, and I'm too tired to rock. Yeah! Woo!
I like some really old rock and roll, that's just... Because the really old rock and roll music, that's an Eddie Cochran song, you know, the really old rock and roll music we were, when I was 6 years old, that was kind of the blues music of rock and roll. It was the early 50s, was the blues music of rock and roll, if you know what I mean. It was the music that came before the 60s, which is why I was a little kid, but was super growing up during that time. Anyway, I really love some really old rock and roll, and it's just sometimes that's what I like to go back to, kind of mentally. When I'm looking for something fresh, I like to go back to the really old stuff, because the Elvis Sunsides are just still some of the most beautiful music. I mean, the way they just slip into you know, Elvis's first song, you know, fuck God, you know, what was it? That's all right now, Mama. Just the way they slip, there's no counting. They just kind of slide into it. It's one of the best beginnings in rock and roll. It's the most beautiful. And most other rock and roll songs don't start like that. There's always a count. A 1, 2, 3, 4, something, or somebody's doing something. But no, they just kind of slide into, that's all right now, Mama. It's one of the most beautiful. It's organic, that's what it is. And it's there's no trickery. It's a little bit right, like right now with this, what we're doing tonight. There ain't no fucking trickery. There's no machine singing for me, you know what I mean? I am the machine that sings. Well, we were talking about Rebel Yell, and we were talking about the 80s, really, but I'd just like to take you back a little bit. Back to when I was first writing songs. It was a very, you know, you to begin writing songs, like, you've heard my first songs. I mean, the first song I ever wrote was Ready, Steady, Go, and it got recorded, you know. It's just crazy being in a punk rock group. Back then, the music got recorded, your very first stuff. Most people's very first songs, they record their songs they've written like after 5 years or something. No, but we're doing, and we're still doing fucking Ready, Steady, Go today. I can't believe it, it's like crazy. But there was on the first Generation X album, there was some really, really good songs. I really think there's some great songs on it. And there's actually a re-release coming up in April of some other mixes from the first album that are gonna be out. So if you're interested in the first Generation X album, there is gonna be a kind of a box set that's coming out in April, this 2019, 42 years later or something. But anyway, it had some really great songs, and just, you know, learning to write songs, beginning to write songs, and sort of reaching beyond what you knew about. I think when we came to write something like Kiss Me Deadly, it really was like we were reaching beyond what we were capable of. But that's what you had to do in those days to make a mark. You really had to reach beyond yourself. But anyway, the song was a beautiful song. Tony James, who my songwriting partner in Generation X, he came up with the lyrics. I used to write the music to Generation X songs. He came up with these great lyrics about two punks kind of negotiating the kind of dark, seedy underground of the sort of life of London in those days, because the world was very polarized. People were incredible. It's rather like today, actually. People were incredibly polarized. That off in little factions, and then the little factions are getting more and more extreme, and then they get violent. And so there was this, it was a violence in the air of the 1977 London, and that's what this song really is about two punks negotiating their way through the London underground, trying to find some great music to give them some answers. It's Kiss Me Deadly. The Greyhound's rocking out tonight to maximum rockabilly. When two punks choose to risk the subway for a tube to Piccadilly. Zephyr stir fast gangs for glory, another dawn casualty. I'm having fun. In Southwest 6, a hidden flick knife. Flicks, oh, who kiss me? Kiss me deadly. Won and lost down the Bishop's End last night, and the spotlights, they hit the kids in triumph with a thousand scars in flight. See how they fall. I said they run from the terraces in black and white, young and old, into the fight. I'm having fun. Southwest 6 with violence for a fix. Oh, kiss me. Kiss me deadly. Tonight. 7 o'clock we stood rank for the 30 bus uptown, and later in a downstairs room she pulls her lover down in ecstasy, cause they can't make a sound in case her mother might come down. We're having fun. Southwest 6 discovering teenage sex. Oh, kiss me. Kiss me deadly a little while ago. We weren't just talking about growing up in the 60s or being very young. I was only six or so, and I really started to love rock and roll music. I love the Beatles, I love the Stones, I love the Who. The Who were just fantastic on things like Top of the Pops. They're just fucking incredible. But I also really love the Animals, and I love the Kinks. The Kinks were an incredible band. And recently I saw their show. There's a show that was on in London called Sunny Afternoon, I think it was called. And they did this really great song that I kind of forgotten about. And I thought, fuck, I've got to cover it. I've got to cover this song. It's such a great song. It's really a punk rock song. I mean, Ray Davies, in some ways, he was one of the earliest punk rockers in some ways, because All Day and All of the Night, You Really Got Me. But this song, I'm Not Like Everybody Else, is killer. It's just it's like a punk rock song. So this is a Kink song by Ray Davies, but it's called I'm Not Like Everybody Else. Well, I won't take it all that they hand me down, make out a smile though I wear a frown. I'm not gonna take it all lying down, cause once I get started I go to town. Cause I'm not like everybody else. No, I'm not like everybody else. No, I'm not like everybody else. I said I'm not like everybody else. Everybody else. But darling, you know that I love you true. Do anything that you want me to. Confess all my sins like you want me to. There's one thing that I say to you. See, I'm not like everybody else. I'm not like everybody else. I said no, I'm not like everybody else. No, I'm not like everybody else. And I don't want to fall about like everybody else. And I don't want to live my life like everybody else. And I won't say that I feel fine like everybody else. Cause I'm not like everybody else. No, I'm not like everybody else. If you all want me to settle down and stop all my running around, do everything that you want me to. There's one thing that I will say to you. See, I'm not like everybody else. No, I'm not like everybody else. I said, no, I'm not like everybody else. No, I'm not like everybody else. And I don't want to fall about like everybody else. And I don't want to live my life like everybody else. And I won't say that I feel fine like everybody else. Cause I'm not like everybody else. Thank you. Alright, well, I've been living in New York for a while, and we've done the first Billy Idol solo album. We've done Rebel Yell, and done incredibly well. Actually, at one point, I think we had Eyes Without a Face was sitting at number 6 in the charts, and the single, I mean, the album was number 4 or something. I mean, it's like incredible, just as well. But anyway, we moved on from that into Whiplash Smile, and by that time, you know, I was in a long-term relationship with Perry Lister, you know, and but we'd broken up temporarily for about 6 months to a year or something. And but of course, I was missing her very much, and New York can be a lonely place when you're missing someone. So I was, you know, one thing you could do if you're a songwriter, you could put it into a song. And I saw this really interesting program about this chap had come all the way from Latvia after he was horribly jilted and left at the altar by his sweetheart, and he came down to Homestead in Florida, and he started to build this really gigantic place made out of huge slabs of granite called the Coral Castle. And he used to take people around this kind of romantic place. It has a moon for a rocking chair. You can actually push this great big granite moon, and it moves, you know, it's like a rocking chair for this person, the person he missed. And when he would take people around this place, when they asked him, why did you build this place? He would say, it's for my sweet 16. So when I came to write a song about me missing Perry, I thought, well, this is perfect. And what a great way to take sweet little 16, drop the sweet, and use just the sweet 16, and fuck me stiff. There's sometimes, that's what I love about rock and roll music, you can do that, and it's beautiful. Anyway, we'll have a go at sweet 16. Thank you. read my heart and engage my head. And she took everything, everything I gave her. Sweet 16. I could move a rocking chair. I never guessed it could rock her far from me.
Too short for basketball, too scrawny for football, and I came out of the womb with a full head of fucking hair. I looked like a little monkey. And if there's anything that we know that's useful in rock and roll, it's a good head of hair. But I always remember, you know, it was such a big deal. It was a huge deal when Elvis had his 1968 comeback special. Because, I mean, he looked incredible, but around him he had his band of, you know, just the best. Elvis always had great guitar players. I think from that time, seeing that, of course, my mom was glued to Elvis, but my dad loved Chet Atkins and all that kind of stuff. Anyway, that guitar player is really good. And my dad came home after seeing that special. I think he paid $13 for a guitar with like a little book. And I made hell of a noise on it, but my dad said, "Yeah, it sounds like crap, but it's in time. It's got rhythm." And at that time, oddly enough, funny enough that we're in San Francisco, we grew up in a two-family house, and my upstairs tenant, her name was Rita Hart, and her son was Mickey Hart, the drummer from the Grateful Dead. He had just come home from, he stayed in our house after his tour of duty in Vietnam, and he gave my brother a couple of drum lessons, and everybody in my neighborhood was like, "Wow, there's a drummer living on the street." That was a big deal for a musician, and I thought, "Wow, it's great." And then, not dating myself too much, but we had the Johnny Carson show, and I remember seeing him. He had Little Richard on, and I thought, anybody who could carve out a life for themselves, that original, that fucking wild, that's for me. That's what I want to do. just like you, I mean, we're probably listening to the same records, An Ocean Apart, Beatles, Kinks, Rolling Stones. I remember when I got my first electric guitar, I think Satisfaction was the first thing that I played. to all that stuff. It was really hard to play Jimi Hendrix or whatever when you got your first guitar, but you could play those Rolling Stones and Beatles songs. So I think that was it, really. You know, I was well on my way.
Yeah. Emotional part. We're digging the same shit one way or another. That's what's great. It's so much about music, the 60s. I mean, because I grew up seeing every hard rock band or whatever. We used to go and see bands every weekend. And I saw virtually everybody from Deep Purple to, I don't know, you name it. So I didn't see Led Zeppelin, but I saw everybody else. I saw Captain Beefheart, Frank Zappa. I don't know, I just saw so many. That's what we're into, music, seriously into music. And it was just happened to be punk rock that we kind of made our mark in, but really we're super into music. But thank you, Steve, for telling us about that, because it always makes you wonder what makes someone, you know, what inspires someone to make a move like playing an axe like this is pretty incredible. All right, well, we're going to do a song that is on the Kings and Queens of the Underground album, and I was actually making this album when my father started to get ill. He started to say he just wasn't hungry anymore. One day he said, "I'm just not hungry, I just don't feel hungry, something's wrong," you know. And but I was playing golf with him and things. He was 86 years old. This is 6 years ago. He was 86 years old and he's playing golf incredibly. I mean, because he didn't clobber the ball or anything. He's just putting it exactly where it needs to be to make it round in par, and then I'm playing and I'm all over the place. I can't even stay on the fairway. It's embarrassing, really, but of course he's just showing me how it should be done. But there he was at 86, looking beautiful. I just thought, man, this guy's gonna be 100 years old, you know, like he's just gonna make it. Look, he's still going strong. Nothing's gonna stop him. Or if it is, it's gonna be something super. That's what I thought. The thing that stops this guy is gonna be something super, you know. So anyway, he thought he needed a hip replacement, so he went into hospital for a hip replacement, and when they did it, and they didn't get all the tests back, you know, they get the myriad of tests, and the one test they didn't wait for was the MRSA. In England they call that Mercer, maybe something different in America, but it's that bug in hospitals, and it's a super bug. It kills old people and very young people, babies, I think. So anyway, they did this operation and they realized too late after they'd done this operation, and the MRSA had gone into the hip replacement, and it started to kill him, you know. So they said to us, well, we can give him this huge amount of antibiotics, and we'll see if that works. So they tried the first bunch of antibiotics, and no, it didn't work. And so they said, okay, we've got another, we'll try again. So they tried another huge dose of antibiotics, and fuck me, no, it didn't work. So now I'm going, shit, this is the thing that's gonna get him, that he's gonna live to 100. I was in denial, you know. But thank God, the third dose of antibiotics worked, and he came through, and I just went, I told you it's gonna be something super that kills him. That didn't fucking do it. Because I saw him, he was standing in front of me without his clothes on, and he's just shredded, you know. It just shredded him, you know. So I knew what it had done to him. It had taken a lot out of him, but still. A year or so after that, 4 years ago or so, he really started to say, I'm just not hungry, there's something wrong. And then we went on a holiday to Portugal, and I heard him say to my mother, you know, this is the last family holiday we're gonna have together. And I was hearing this, and I was just going, no, he's gotta be mistaken. But he knew. And he knew, and he had cancer, and that's when we found out he had lung cancer, and he hadn't really smoked since he was 30. But he was a salesman, and so he was always in a room of smoke. You know, I remember the sales office. It was always, everybody smokes, there's a smoke everywhere. Anyway, so basically he had lung cancer. It was just a matter of time before it got him. But I came back to England to take care of him, to help my sister and my mother. And, you know, so it gave us some sort of quality time, funnily enough, where we did spend time together. And my dad actually one day said to me, because, you know, he always gave me a hard time about loving music. He just didn't think it was, you know, anybody could have he thought it was weird, you know, as people being in show business, they thought it was show business, you know, like we go, fuck, it's rock and roll, Dad, it's not show business, it's nothing to do with fucking show business, fuck, we fucking hate show fucking business. You know, it's nothing to do with that, but they just didn't see, they just thought that, you know, being a performer is a weird, you know, it is weird, he's right, it is fucking weird. I didn't know that then, but now, I know that now. I didn't know that then, but anyway, we had some times together. He knew he'd given me a hard time about loving music, and I'd gone on and fucking done it anyway, kind of to show him, really. I think, fuck you, Dad. I'm going to fucking show you. You're going to watch me on the telly, so you're going to see me up there in a minute on top of the fucking... And there I was, on top of the fucking pot. I mean, we didn't have loads of hit records, but you know what I mean? There I was. I'm in a band, we're making records and stuff. It was really cool, but he'd give me a hard time. So I knew when we were spending this time together, when he was kind of basically dying, really. I mean, it wasn't only a few months before he was going to, you know, expire, really. And, you know, one day, as I was kind of helping him into bed, and, you know, he really had to lift him into bed and everything. He could do things for himself at all. And I put him into bed and I got him settled down and got his drink and his glasses and some of his pill, whatever it was, stuff around him so that he didn't, you know. And I could see there was something he wanted to say to me. I could see in his eyes, I could see there was a hurt, there was something going on. And he said to me, he said, "Billy, did I upset you that I didn't understand about your music?" And, you know, I thought to myself in a blinding flash, God, I could be such an arsehole in this moment. I could say all the wrong things. I could say, yes, you fucking did. Do you know what you fucking did, man? You fucking did. You fucking put me through the ringer because you didn't fucking understand. I could be like that. But I could see in his eyes, it was such a love there. And it's such a want, a need to hear the right thing. And I looked at him and I said, you know, Dad, I was fucking crazy to think I could do it. And I'm right, I am crazy to think I can do this, but that is why you do something like this. You don't do it because it's easy, you do it because it's something you have to do. It's something inside you have to get out. And this is one hell of a way of doing it, but that was the answer to my dad. I was crazy to think I could do it, Dad. And I could see the relief in his eyes. He was so relieved. I just knew at that moment we'd connected, we'd sort of connected again. Whatever had happened when I was young or whatever happened, we'd connected in that moment, and I just knew this was the magical moment that had to happen if I was gonna grow up and be a man, so to speak, you know. But anyway, he really liked the Kings and Queens of the Underground album, and I know he was listening to it in the hospice when he really was passing on. And I know that he was listening to it as he actually died. And I believe this next song we're gonna do, Ghosts in My Guitar, that this is the song he was listening to when he passed on. Down on Avenue A, didn't have a reason, didn't have much more to say. Well, last time I saw him, he was looking green, you know. Some people never make it out of this scene. Like Rudy took a hit around chapter 9. Adios, my friend, we had one hell of a time. When I think of you, there's a voice in my head that says without fire, we're better off dead. And I thank you all. I'll never forget the ghost in my guitar. Terry told me that she loved me true. Next time I looked around, she'd run off with you. Well, I was out there playing round the world. No time to think about another lost girl. When I think of you, there's a voice in my head that says without fire, we're better off dead. I thank you all. Yes, I'll never forget the ghost in my guitar. Billy is my name, and you know me well. I've played every game, and yes, I walked into hell. Yes, down on my luck I played the fool. Had you to live for, now I'm back in for good. And when I think of you, there's a voice in my head that says without fire, we're better off dead. I thank you all. Yes, I'll never forget the ghost in my guitar. Ghost in my guitar. Could only take me so far. The ghost in my guitar. Cause I've got to walk on. The ghost in my guitar. Is my mum's 91. She was 91 in February. I think she's going to make it to 100, so there you go. Good old mum! I'll be seeing her in May. I'm going to go over and see her. She's 91. So good on her. Let's do eyes without a face. Thank you. Yes, I wonder why I don't despise. Now all I can do is love her once. So alive and new, the girl is gone from your eyes. I should realize.
Thank you. Thank you.
like Johnny Ray. He's always cracky high. About rockabilly a little bit earlier, about the Elvis Sunside. Well, there's a version we do of To Be a Lover where we can rockabilly idle it. Yeah, we can go all rockabilly. So let's do that now. Let's do a rockabilly version of To Be a Lover.
Thank you.
my baby. I said, mercy, mama, have mercy. I'm gonna make it all through. Got to be a lover, forgot to be a lover. I got to be a lover, baby.
Yeah, talking about Rebel Yell a bit earlier, that's my favourite song, it really is. The easiest song to introduce, it only takes two words, and those two words are... Rebel Yell! Tears of pain. times. For you. I'd sell my soul to you, babe. It's worth some money to burn for you. Thank you all for coming. Really fantastic. This is a little bit of an experiment, but at the same time, I'd just like to thank you. I'd like to thank you for making my life so fucking great. Thank you. And Steve Stevens, just like to thank you for making my life so fucking great. Thank you, Steve. And Steve, show them what a hit song sounds like, will ya?
See, I've been away.
We're just going to rock out on that with Shaking All Over, yeah. Thank you. You've been fantastic. Thank you. See you next time. You've been fantastic. Rock on, San Francisco. Yeah.